Hello everyone, my name is Maciej Gajdzica, and today I will talk about safety critical systems, which are the systems that in case of malfunction may cause human death or other serious consequences like environment pollution or destruction of expensive equipment. And to prevent that from happening, we create those systems in a special way, using some special techniques for safety and reliability that are not used in normal systems. Safety critical systems are common in medical industry, in automotive, in aerospace, railway transportation, also nuclear power plants, industrial control and military. And due to advancement of technology, hardware miniaturization, artificial intelligence and Internet of Things, we are creating more and more of those devices, also in Poland. And someday, maybe even one of you will be working on such a system. And even if not, I hope that this presentation will encourage you to think more about quality of the software. A few words about me. I work in Solvit company in Gdańsk. I am embedded software developer, and I work in embedded systems for 7 years and for 4 years in safety critical. I was involved in a project of railway traffic control, medical system, and now automotive systems. I also run a blog, usigosu.pl, which is in Polish, and you can also find me on Twitter. We use software from a few decades now, and we had enough time to learn that we cannot depend on it too much. We know that a program could crash, it could corrupt our data, destroy our files, or even hang the entire system. And we don't care. We know that this happens, so we don't trust our programs that much. And as developers, the situation is beneficial for us because there is not that much pressure for us to do everything perfectly. We sometimes even abuse this fact, and we have this term fail early, fail often, which means that we need to focus on shipping our software as fast as we can and fix all the issues later, when we know that this software is good. And this approach is, of course, correct for most of the systems, but sometimes we must do everything right on the first try. And it may be hard. Uncle Bob said that quality of software that we are creating is rather bad. We don't use good practices. We even have trouble formulating them. We run our projects in a chaotic way, and this is only a matter of time before there will be a huge catastrophe because of software that will focus on us, eyes of politicians, and some government regulations will be created to limit some freedom of software developers. So now let's see what already happened in that matter. This is Terak 25, the radiotherapy equipment from the 80s. And between 1985 and 1987, there were 12 of these devices working in USA and Canada. And it's the most infamous example of software error that caused human death. There were 6 accidents involving excessive patient radiation, which resulted in death of those patients. How that happened? Terak 25 could work in two modes. In electron mode, the low energy beam were created and were pointed to the patient directly. there were also another mode called X-ray mode, where high energy beams were created. And it went through the special filter, and only after that could be applied on patient body. There was a special mechanical arm here that was responsible for placing this filter in the final position. The problem was that in some specific cases, it was possible for this filter, for this beam to be generated before filter is in its final position, causing overdosing up to 1,000 times more than the value prescribed by doctor. Families of the victims went to the court, and expert witnesses analyzed the problem. They looked into the software and what they found. Here you can see some pseudocode. Original TERAC 25 code were written in assembly language. Here you can see some configuration functions. And on the left, you can see that the function magnet is called, which is responsible for configuring hardware of the magnets that were on the device head. And it was responsible for generating this beam. And in this function magnet, we see that the flag for configuration is set. And then in the loop, we set the hardware configuration of every magnet. The hardware needs some time to apply those configuration values, so we also needed a delay. But this delay had a loop with exit condition, and after loop is ended, the flag was cleared. The problem was that it was cleared after the first magnet, but was set before the loop in the magnet function, so it was never set again for the next magnets. Here you have exit condition depending on this flag, so it was impossible to stop the old configuration when operator changed values, and that created a possibility of generating high energy beam when low energy beam was expected. But the experts were not happy with finding only the exact places in the code that contributed to this error. They were sure that this is only the effect of development process, and the root cause were something else. So they wanted to dig deeper. And what did they found? It turns out that the whole program was implemented by a single person. He is not competent enough to do a program in assembly language with multitasking, which, by the way, is something really hard. And there were no code reviews, there were no supervision for him. He also didn't provide any documentation, he didn't gather requirements, there were no architecture documents. So the software quality were quite bad, but this was not the only problem. Another problem were at the decision level, because there were a faulty risk assessment. In earlier version of the product, it wasn't possible to physically start a high energy beam before filter is in place, because there are some mechanical interlocks. And they decided that since now software is responsible for that, we don't need software interlocks anymore. Also, tests were insufficient. The whole device were set up for the first time in the first hospital where it's supposed to work. There were no prior system tests before. Also, handling of customer requests were quite bad. Because the crew of hospitals reported from the beginning that something might be wrong with the software, but all of those requests were frowned upon by the producer, claiming that they operate it wrongly, they don't maintain it as good as they should. And they were later forced to check their software. As a result, the company lost the case in the court. They had to pay huge reparations to families of the victims. The device were withdrawn from the market. Company completely lost its reputation and had to completely withdraw from medical industry. The second case, which I will talk about, is Ariane 5 rocket, which during its first flight in 1996 exploded about 40 seconds after the start. Here you can see the timeline of events that led to this accident. And interesting things start after about 36 seconds when SRI module stopped working. This module were responsible for estimating position of the rocket, and estimation is calculated based on its value from the previous iteration and data from sensors. After this module fails, we lost history of data and we are not able to create a close enough estimation of our position. Engineers knew that this module is crucial for correct operation of the rocket, so they created a backup module that should take over in case of any failure. But as you can see here, both of those modules failed at almost the same time. This is because those modules were exactly the same and then they run the same software containing the same bug. So the rocket lost information about its position and started to turn, and after a few seconds, auto-destruction procedure were fired. This rocket didn't have any crew on board, so nothing wrong happened to them. But again, as in the previous example, the special commission were created to analyze the problem. And what did they found? It turns out that the whole accident were because integer with 16 bits overflowed. And this was done during cast from 64 bits floating point number. And here you can see code responsible for that. It was written in ADA, so it may be not that readable for you, but those variables were responsible for velocity calculations. And here you can see checks done for one of the variables. You can see here some variables specific for integer 16 conversion. But here at the bottom, there were another variable that were not checked before the conversion, and it caused this accident. But once again, the experts tried to find the root cause of the problem, and they found some interesting things. It turned out that this variable that caused the accident were not needed at all in the software. It was placed there only because it was copy-pasted from the previous version of the rocket. And in previous version, in Ariane 4, it worked with no problem for several years. Because engineers made risk assessment and they stated that this variable couldn't overflow because physical model of the rocket doesn't allow this velocity variable to be that big. But for the new version of the rocket, this physical model changed and now overflow were possible, and they didn't repeat this assessment. But there were also some things with testing, because simulation tests worked with production version of navigation module, but the SRI module that failed were mocked in the simulation, but nothing prevented them to use a production version of its code and mock only sensor data. They repeated this test after the accident, and it led to exactly the same results. Of course, I can show you some more examples of costly software failures, but even after those two, we can go into some conclusions. First of all, we are only human. We make mistakes, even if we are skilled and experienced. So it's not enough to only base our quality process on individual skill of engineers. Engineers need some kind of safety net, so they are sure that even if they fail, this error won't come into the final product and cause any dangerous situation. Because of that, some software norms were created. Here you can see numbers of many norms from various industries. The first one is a general standard, and from that standard, some domain-specific standards were created. So we have medical one, automotive, nuclear, railway, aerospace, and even NASA guidelines. So the words that Uncle Bob said are already true. We already had some tragic accidents because of software, and we already have some regulations. And now let's see what this safe process of developing software looks like. It's called V-model, and it consists of three parts: designing, implementation, and verification. During designing, we create general concept, we gather requirements, create architecture, some design details, we implement it, we test it on various levels. We also need to verify that after we created the software, this is the same software that we wanted to create. So we compare some documents. Also, before this goes into the production, there is a verification step where independent body is involved. And it's crucial that this body for certification is independent. So we have no pressure from stakeholders to skip some tests because we need faster time to market. And this V-model owes its characteristic shape to the fact that everything on the left is tested by something on the right. So implementation is checked by unit tests, design is checked by component tests, system tests checks architecture, and so on. We also have documents that checks design documents, so we know that we created exactly what we want. And if you hear about documents, you may think that this process must be very bureaucratic. And you are right. Here you can see names of documents that should be created on every level. And here one thing comes to our mind, because this looks like a classical example of big design up front of waterfall process. And we know from at least 20 years that this process is not effective, that we know that this way we cannot build software of high quality. So why should we create such critical devices in a way that we know is wrong for that? And this is not exactly true. And I have this statement from medical norm, which says that standards doesn't impose on us any particular life cycle. We have some freedom here. As long as some activities are done, which have certain attributes and create specific documents as an output. And of course, in real life, we must do this iteratively. Another thing about which I want to talk are safety levels, because effects of error in different systems are not the same. So we must do something more for software that in case of error will do more harm. So we have something like safety integrity level. And this first industrial norm defines something like as seal. We have seal 4, which is the biggest, and it means that in case of failure of such a system, life of many people is in danger. In seal level 3, life of a single person is in danger, seal level 2, that severe injury is possible, and on level 1, minor injury is possible. There is also a concept of seal level 0, where nothing wrong will happen in case of error, but we still need to do it in bigger quality. And all of those seal levels have specific numerical variables that describes them. Those variables are probability of dangerous failure per hour. And for the highest level, we have a probability of failure between 10 to minus 9 and 10 to minus 8. And that means that if we have thousands of devices in production that works for 10 years, we are allowed to have only a few incidents. And as you can see, for every lower level, those probability variables are dropped by one order of magnitude. But even on the seal level 1, there are still big and hard to maintain. We have other levels in another norms. Here you can see avionic norms, which maps good to safety integrity levels. They have something called design assurance levels, DAL. Level A is the biggest, and it means that in case of error, it's possible to have a crash of the aircraft and all of the passengers will be dead. On level B and C, there are bigger and smaller problems with operating the aircraft. Level D means that we have no significant reduction in safety of aircraft, and level E, no reduction at all. Other classes are for medical devices, where we have class C, which means that death or serious injury is possible. Class B means that smaller injury is possible, and class A means no injury is possible at all. And here also you can raise a question, because fine, we have this probabilistic matrix for safety integrity levels, but how could we maintain those metrics during the product lifecycle? We cannot measure them during the project. We cannot intervene if we see that the value is too high. We need to have the device working for some time to gather statistics, only to know that we are inside the threshold. So how that could help us? And of course, we cannot use this metrics for existing project. The best thing that we can do is to measure those probabilities for products that works in production. And if we identify some products that have the correct probability numbers, we can use the same practices that they were using in hope that it will lead also our project to have this low failure rate. That's why software norms are full of those table of recommended techniques. What you can see here is a table from a railway norm. And what we have here? First is name of the technique. Then we have a reference to the chapter where technique is described more. Then we have columns for every safety integrity level. And we have in the fields HR, which is highly recommended, R, which is recommended, NR, which is not recommended, and M, which is mandatory. Okay, but as you can see, there are a lot of those techniques, and we just cannot use all of those techniques in the single project. So norms help us somehow. They create some guidelines for us. And here you can see the table for testing and quality assurance. And as you can see here, four software integrity levels, 3 and 4. We have approved a combination of techniques, 3, which is dynamic analysis and testing, 5, which is traceability. Traceability is a property of our system that we can track the way from the requirement to things in the design that are responsible for this requirement, to specific lines of code, and to tests of various levels that cover this requirement. And we need this traceability first to know that we don't have any dead code, and also to make it easier to make changes later. Other techniques proposed are 7, which is test coverage, 8, functional and black box testing, and 1 of 1 to 6, formal proof, static analysis, and software error effect analysis. So one of the techniques that checks quality of the software without running it. And as you can see, for levels 1 and 2, we have reduced set of techniques, only traceability, and 1 of 2, 3, 8, static analysis, dynamic analysis and testing, and functional and black box testing. Going into the software recommendation, coding standards are mandatory for safety integrity levels 3 and 4. They consist of some recommended and forbidden software constructs, and they are particularly useful for languages like C or C++, where it's really easy to shoot yourself in the foot, and we can increase the safety of our product only by disabling some software constructs. Another interesting thing is that we don't should use dynamic memory allocation. This is because of 2 things. First of all, dynamic memory allocation have not deterministic times, so we cannot reason about worst case execution scenarios, and we cannot obtain some real-time requirements. The second issue is even more important, because those systems could work without any reset for example, 10 years, and issues because of memory fragmentation may be big and hard to predict. There are some other limitations, like limited use of pointers. In case of data pointers, we don't want to overwrite data of other module. And in case of function pointers, we don't want to execute unwanted code. Limited use of recursion because of possibility of stack overflow. And some less controversial, like limited use of global variables. Here we can see recommendation for software. And the first one is AIDA, which is not controversial at all, because AIDA is considered the safest language. It was created by US military to create code for supersonic fighters. And the AIDA have a very strict compiler that prevents us to create runtime error. It reports almost everything at compile time. But we have 2 other highly recommended languages that are quite strange, Modula 2 and Pascal. We don't use those languages anymore. We don't use them for many, many years. But they are still here because there were some academic researches about safety of languages, and they claim that those languages have some properties that make them safer than most of commonly used languages. Those features are, for example, another string implementation without zero termination, or some more explicit casting. Another interesting thing is that C and C++, in which most of the embedded systems are created, are just recommended. And at the same level of recommendation, there are C-sharp and Java. And of course, C-sharp and Java are safer languages than C or C++, but we have some problems here. For example, we cannot avoid dynamic memory allocation. Also, safety critical systems couldn't work on Windows or Linux. So we use some real-time operating systems, which don't provide a runtime environment to run C-sharp or Java. There are also some languages that are not listed here. I hope that no one will try to create safety critical system in JavaScript or Python, but there are some languages that are better suited for that, for example, Rust. And Rust is quite a new language. It's still changed frequently, and there were no big projects that worked for several years that were written in Rust. But I think that after some years, Rust also will be a highly recommended language. Okay, another thing is how to ensure the safety at the project level, because the naive approach would be to first implement all of the features and only after that introduce required safety. And this is the same situation as writing tests after implementation. Of course, we can do that. Of course, we will have some results, but it will never be with high enough quality. Also, sometimes we want to prevent some risks at design level, and after we have implementation finished, it will be harder to change. The other approach that won't succeed is to create some smaller elements that will be safe and then merging them together. And again, this will not work because the most problematic part of every system is to make integration between those modules right. And if we do modules safe in isolation, we cannot guarantee that they will also work when combined. So the only solution is to care about safety from the start of the project. And how can we do it? We have a technique called risk analysis, and it looks like this. During some activities like writing code, meetings, documentation, testing, and so on, we see some corner cases, some things that we didn't cover, and so on, that could be potentially risky for our system. So we create a list of those issues, and then we assign to them two values. Severity of the issue, is this issue catastrophic, or maybe critical, or maybe effects will be not that big. And the second value is probability. Are they frequent, probable, maybe improbable, or eliminated at all? When we have those two values, we place our risk on this matrix, which is divided into some regions. And when we are in not allowed region for our safety integrity level, we can do one of two things. We can add something to make the consequences of the error lighter, or we can do something to make it less probable, to move it down. And we can do it in three ways. We can use hardware, software, and people and processes for that. The best way is to use hardware, because hardware is fast, is automatic, is always give the same result. Also, it fails in predictable manner and is quite simple. Second place is for software, which is also fast and repeatable, and also can cover much more complicated scenarios. But we really cannot prove that our software doesn't contain any errors. And of course, the worst idea is to use people and processes, because people just make mistakes. And how those three combine into providing more safety? We can look at the typical procedure called safe state, and it flows like this. We have our system, which is in normal state, and then something wrong happens. We detect this error and go into the safe state. So we put all our hardware in the state where it cannot harm anybody. So for example, we turn off the engines and do all of this input-output stuff, and then go into the infinite loop. So we cannot return to regular operation. Then we wait for the operator, and he can make decision if he wants to replace the device or maybe restart it. Restart is the only way to resume regular operation. And as a side note, I have one piece of advice for you. If you will be creating some medical devices and you will implement this safe state, do not place a fatal error message to the patient. They don't respond that good to that. Okay, we have this safe state, but sometimes we just cannot wait for the operator to intervene. This is a special kind of system. For example, if we have a rocket that will go into space, we cannot just wait for the operator. We must do everything to make it come back to Earth, and only after that it's in its safe state. We called those systems mission critical systems, and our best friend here to have enough safety is to use redundancy. So we duplicate the modules to remove single points of failure. And in case of processors, that means that we will have multiprocessor systems. And for us, multiprocessors is for adding performance. But here, performance of the system could be even worse. But what we gain is more safety. The easiest solution that improves safety is a system with supervisor CPU. So we have this one processor that is doing most of the stuff, and we have second processor that analyzes its inputs and outputs, and if it detects that something is wrong, it can prevent it from working. Okay. The next thing is in a system with two independent channels. It's more complicated than previous example. We have two independent channels which have its own inputs, its own outputs, and even the same internal modules. And those internal modules exchange information, and when they detect that something goes wrong, they can do some action. They can, for example, go into safe state or can do something else, depending on the situation. Even more complicated system used, for example, in aerospace is voting system, where we have even more independent channels and some system at the output that is this voting machine. So it analyzes output from every subsystem and creates some agreed result. And here, of course, we must care about redundancy of this system, because it could be our single point of failure. And regarding those independent channels, there is some interesting concept called diverse programming, which means that each independent channel is implemented by another team, and those teams do not communicate with each other. They only use the same documentation, the same requirements, the same maybe architecture documents. And this is because we want to avoid errors like in Ariane 5, where we have the same bug in both redundant systems. And there are many ways to implement this diversification. For example, we can use other hardware, other CPU architecture, other programming languages, or some programming techniques. Another thing is some random errors, because if we work with normal systems, there are some things that just happened and we doesn't care. For example, cosmic radiation. We can just restart our system in that case and no big deal. But if we are creating space shuttle for NASA, which will work in space where cosmic radiation is a thing, and also it costs billions of dollars, it would be silly to destroy our system only because of cosmic radiation. So we must protect against those non-deterministic things that can interfere with our systems. And I read some statistics from NASA, which claims that they have incidents involving cosmic radiation in their space missions once for every 20, 30 minutes. So this problem is not that improbable. And what could go wrong if we have some of those errors? What you can see here is Constantine mission from NASA from 1992. The objective of this mission were to explore further planets in the solar system. And after about half a year of this mission, something went wrong. They lost contact from a base at the Earth, and the one of the engines of the rocket were at full speed. So the rocket started to turning rapidly, and they couldn't stop that because of this broken communication. The communication were restored after a few minutes, but it turns out that they don't have enough fuel to continue mission. They lacked a simple system called Watchdog, which is responsible for resetting the system when it becomes not responsive. But NASA learned on their mistakes. A few years later, in 1997, they had a Pathfinder mission, which placed on Mars this rover. But software of this rover contained deadlock, and it couldn't continue its mission, but this time Watchdog were in place. It was possible to reset this device, contact with base on the Earth, remotely update the software, and continue the mission. How do we deal with those errors? We can do sanity checks and runtime tests to detect them. There are many kinds of tests. We have, for example, RAM tests, which write some patterns into the cells, so we can detect when some bit is stuck at zero or one, or we have some coupling between the adjacent cells. We have also non-volatile memory tests, which are basically CRC checksums. We have CPU tests, which are quite interesting. We have registers tests, which are similar to RAM tests. And we have instruction tests. Those instruction tests are some kind of unit tests for assembly instructions. And we want to make sure that, that due to some, for example, cosmic radiation or something else, the transistors inside logic gates are not broken and our assembly instructions work still as we want them to work. We have also other tests, for example, power supply tests, sensor tests, clock tests, and so on. Another thing is code reuse. This is very tempting for us to use existing code from old project or some existing library, because it can save enormous amounts of time. But we must remember that with this code, we also inherit some problems of this code. And norms also know this problem, and they have special term for that, SOAP, software of unknown provenance. And there are some problems with that existing software, because most likely it's not suited to be used in this software standards. So the burden of make it compliant with standards are on us. And most probably this software had no proper documentation. We don't know about its development process. So we must provide all of that by ourselves, with which costs much more time than to buy something which is ready and pre-certified. And it turns out that it's better to buy even something which is very, very expensive than to try to do it by ourselves. Okay, about money. I heard that safety critical systems are up to 10 times more expensive than normal systems. And I have some data from aviation. Here we have a chart of lines of code per hour. We have those design assurance levels, where level A is the biggest, and our productivity is between 3 and 12 lines of code per hour. And for design assurance level D, those values are much, much bigger. And of course, it doesn't mean that we write only 3 lines of code every hour. It means that the whole production code after the project ends, divided by all the time spent and all the people involved, gives us those values. And of course, there are other activities than only writing the code. We must have some meetings, we do code reviews, testing, certification, and so on. And here you can see distribution of activities between various design assurance levels. And as you can see here, most of the things are quite the same for every level, and the biggest difference is in verification phase. And this, of course, doesn't mean that we do both systems at the same speed, and then at the end we must do much more paperwork. The truth is that those verification activities are spread throughout the whole project. So we do those code reviews, design reviews, certification, and so on during the whole project, and it takes much longer for higher levels. Okay, ending my presentation, I want to answer the question, should we be afraid of software regulations? Because if such authority like Uncle Bob is scaring us that it may be something that we might not like, maybe it's a thing. I am working on safety critical systems for quite some time, and I must say that software regulations are not that bad, and they can be our ally also, because we as software developers are the ones who care about quality. We want good processes, we want test automation, we want continuous integration, we want reviews, and so on. And many times we cannot have this in our project because of some deadlines, because of some other issues. And here we just have to have those things, because otherwise our system won't be certified and couldn't be shipped. Of course, there are some downsides, and most notably it's much more paperwork, but it's not that bad. And with this positive accent, I want to end my presentation. Thank you for your attention.